things, so he will finish off the workshop.
Okay, thank you. Well, the good thing of being the last one is that I can ask you to thank Intan for the organization of the workshop. Sunya and the person of the institute. I think that the hosting was really nice, and I thank you for organizing this thing so well. And such an effort. Okay, so let me go back to the setting of my talk. So let me recall the notation. So I will denote R gamma. Well, gamma is a finite symmetric group. The variety of representations, which is not an irreducible variety, but it's an algebraic set. The variety of characters that we write x of gamma. Oh, yes. And remember that this is a quotient in algebraic category, which means that the functions on R gamma that are invariant by conjugation, polynomial functions, are the same as polynomial functions here. So in algebraic, I think that you write this like this. I don't have for me now. That's the same. Okay. So the polynomial functions on the variety of representations that are invariant by conjugations are precisely this. What Processi proved is that this is finally generated by some trace functions, and this gives you the coordinates for the variety of characters. However, I will be interested in understanding this quotient a little bit more. So if we restrict to reducible representations that are writing like this, there is a well-defined notion of reducible characters. And the fiber of this map, well, this is in fact a principal one. Right? I mean, two reducible representations with the same character are conjugate, so they have the same fiber. This is the action by conjugation. That's a principal one. Okay. And there is also the component that Antonin calls geometric, that I call distinguished, that some people call canonical. So, distinguished component. Or geometric, canonical. For hyperbolic manifolds of finite volume, which are not compact. And if they are compact, it's just a point. So, the interior will be hyperbolic. So I take M3 compact, oriented, not only orientable. Stefan, let's not notice it. Compact oriented. The interior of M3 is hyperbolic with finite volume. So this means that the ends are capped. So the boundary of M3 is a union of tori. Dijon union. K tori. I consider a lift of the holonomy. And I need there are more structures, but there is only one complete structure. And this is part of the variety of characters is studies the deformations, but most of Prasad-Resi tells you that there is only one lift. Well, there is one holonomy representation. It's oriented. There are several lifts, but I just take one. So X0 is the component of the variety of characters that contains. Character of this, and the theorem is that this is the dimension of this component is the number of ends of the Hyperbolic manifold, and moreover that this is a smooth point of the character. In particular, this means that it belongs to only one component of dimension k. Well, I didn't know very well how to state it. This theorem this is more or less where I stopped last day. Before going to the to the work with symmetries and so on, I need to talk a little bit about this. From one side, so the proof has two ingredients. One is the estimate that Antonin was talking, is that the dimension is at this k, and the other one is the Zariski tangent space. Has dimension. Has dimension of the number of ends. So if you are in a knot, it has dimension one, and so on. I need to talk a little bit about this. I will talk about this Zariski tangent space. I will not define what's the Zariski tangent space, but the basic tool or set theorem, perhaps a proposed, or it's easy to prove, but it's our math theorem, is that if rho is irreducible, now I take that's a general fact, doesn't need to be a three manifold. If rho is irreducible and just irreducible, then this Zariski tangent space is a cohomology group. I'm talking about group cohomology. why this is true? So, I mean, to compute this Zariski tangent space, you need to use this fact and then to compute cohomology. And that's something very useful. And I think that this was more or less, this comes from mathematics from the 60s. I think that Weyl started with this, but I'm not sure who was the first. But there are two, why this is true? I mean, first of all, what's the group cohomology? So let me define, it will be the quotient of co-cycles by co-boundaries. So what are the co-cycles, the group co-cycles, and rho? Those are just is the maps from gamma to the Lie algebra. I realize that maybe I should write, okay. So that's the theta gamma 1 gamma 2. It's not theta gamma 1 but plus gamma 2, but it's twisted by the adjoint. So this is also called group, and that's for every gamma 1, gamma 2. Those are also called cross tomomorphism. And in fact, it's easy to see that this there is a natural identification between these guys, those guys, these cross homomorphisms, those cocycles, with the tangent space of the variety of representations. Oops, rho gamma. There is a rho here, sorry, I start to make things. Because what's the idea? The idea is if you consider the representation of the box gamma 2 1 plus t theta, well, that's the identity, sorry, t theta gamma times rho gamma, that's a representation up to first order. Here there is a t, so up to t squared, or modulo. I mean, you look at first order terms, then you look at power series if you want to say that. This is a representation if and only if theta is a cocycle. So that's something that you can compute by hand. And with this identification, if you call V1 gamma the group of inner automorphism, so there are, sorry, inner cocycles or co-boundaries, so there are the guys in this Z, such that you write it like this, theta of gamma is the identity minus adjoint of rho applied to A, for some in the real algebra. Well, using the identification, this goes to the co-boundary, to the tangent space, to the orbit by conjugation. And in fact, I wrote that this is a principal bundle. Well, since this is a principal bundle, then the cohomology is a quotient. This is not identified when rho is irreducible. The cohomology, which is the quotient of cocycles by co-boundaries, this is not identified with the tangent space to the variety of characters, to the character of rho. So I think of the Tarinski tangent space as analytic path up to first order. So I look at the power series and I forget about the terms with t squared. Just the constant terms plus linear terms times t. And these are the tangent vectors. Well, that's a natural, that's a standard thing. That's very elementary. And this gives me this identification. So we have this isomorphism, which is quite naive, but, and then the theorem, the strong theorem is due to, I think it's due to Raghunathan. At least it's very well explained in Raghunathan's book. And Raghunathan has a much more general theorem that includes that, is that this cohomology group is Cn, Ck. In fact, maybe I'm lying here, because what he really shows is that the restriction map, okay, this is the same as the cohomology of M. This restriction map is zero. But he doesn't say that precisely. He proves a vanishing theorem for L2 cohomology that says that. Okay? Because this is proof using using the Ramm cohomology, because it's the same as the cohomology of the manifold, and then you have to take the right band, the corresponding bundle, and so on. He put it in the closed case was also, I think, was already due to André Weil. And then there is a lot of machinery that people develop. For instance, Matsushima Murakami, they gave they have proof, they have property twos and so on, but well, this is, once this is zero, that's, no, it's injective, sorry. That's zero kernel. And here, that's an L2 vanishing. Okay, because when you have a differential form here, which vanishes here, then you can realize it by an L2 form. In fact, by a form with compact support, but L2 cohomology vanishes, so this injects here, and these are torus, these are easy to understand.
So how about define the last one, about H1 and
potential? Pardon, what, how do we find what? What does it say here?
Homology, how it defines.
This cohomology?
Both, yeah.
The RAM cohomology.
Non-abelian RAM.
Pardon? Non-abelian, it's with one bundle. You consider one. The adjoint bundle over the manifold. With five or the Lie algebra.
So it's what kind of cohomology?
The RAM cohomology.
The RAM.
Yeah. That's the RAM cohomology.
RAM.
Oh, the H was it's the RAM cohomology, just.
Non-abelian,
you mean differential forms? It's a twist bundle, yeah. I mean, you have to consider a bundle twist. Another bundle is what is. You take X3, you multiply by the Lie algebra, and here you have the action of the group.
So, can I represent as the shift cohomology?
Yes, sure. I mean, shift cohomology tells you that all cohomologies, all these cohomologies are the same. Yeah. The only thing is that they were using the language of differential form, right? It's shift cohomology, yeah. But this tells more. This tells, I mean, if you go and look at this, what it tells is that all the formations is what Antonin was saying. All the information comes from the boundary. Local deformations, they do come from the boundary. And that's, well, all this machinery was set up in the 60s, and then Thurston came with these ideas, but well, he didn't really care about all this machinery. But it's not so complicated. It's just all language, right? I mean, you know these kind of things very well, Wolf. It's just what you want. Because I'm going to use this theorem, okay? The key point is that you can compute this cohomology is very easy to compute. It's just you can compute it from the point of view of group theory. It's just matrices and Lucidan things and just with linear algebra. And you have these powerful theorems which use the RAM cohomology and so on that say that, well, they use deep ideas of Andrea Tibesentini and these Bochner formulas that tells you these kind of things, okay. But this is very classical. The only thing is that, people, you find this theorem, for instance, in the book of Worrell and Wallace, but if you're not a specialist in representation theory, this is not an easy book. But there is a book, the book of Ragnatan is quite clear. The only thing is that people in three manifolds are kind of scared of that. Well, some people. Okay, some of my classmates. And I will not give names. Okay, so this is the ingredient to prove this theorem. So let me go to Knox symmetries now. So somehow I will show something that, I mean, what I said is that, okay, with this distinguished component, you can prove, I mean, the main motivation by Thurston was to prove the hyperbolic infinite theorem, right? Because here, this has dimension k, so there is one point that corresponds to the complete hyperbolic structure, but around here, it's a nice neighborhood, and we know we have a lot of structures which are not complete, but the metric completion can give you something very nice. An orbifold, a manifold, many things. So it's a very interesting result. But somehow these people were interested in this, and there is color channels theory that I did put in my abstract, but I will not explain at all because this would need more than 1 hour. I want to explain a silly and rudimentary use of the variety of characters in a joint work with Luisa Paolucci. So when I criticize my co-authors, I don't mean Luisa, eh? Joint with Luisa.
I'm not writing anymore right now.
Oh, this is recorded, okay. I should be aware of that before. Okay. So let's move to the world of not symmetries. Not symmetry. So we take a note and it will not be the figurative knot, I'm sorry, because it has some symmetries, but I need more symmetries than that. So K will be a knot in S3. Not yet a number field. It will be a number field at some point, but for the moment it's a knot. What's a symmetry? A symmetry is a finite order diffeomorphism. Of the pair. And I write P with the not the order of phi. P doesn't need to be a prime, but it could be a prime. This means that P power of phi is the identity, but the earlier powers are not. Okay? And you have several kinds of diffeomorphisms, either with fixed points, either without fixed points. So phi is a phi symmetry. This phi r has no fixed point, so I write it like this. Eccentric. And we also say that phi is a periodic symmetry. If the fixed point set is not empty. So, a colleague of mine says that knot theory is like botanics. That you look at another case. So people in knot theory are very interested, or have been very interested in knot symmetries, because you have a lot of knots and you want to classify, you want to understand them. And the symmetries are a property that they can study about knots, right? So they study invariants of knots and they say, okay, it can be symmetric, they have a symmetry, there is no symmetry. So what I want to use here is that I think that people never don't use it, is the variety of characters to distinguish these two cases. Well, there is a third case.
Sorry, just the...
Yes.
The fixed point set with domain in S3 or in S3 minus K?
In S3.
Yeah, okay.
Yes. But, well, I'm not considering the unknown, so it has to be larger, yeah? Well, there is a third possibility, right? That phi doesn't have fixed points, but the power of phi has fixed points. Yeah? If p is prime, this will not appear, but there is a third possibility. It is, I don't remember how is it called. Pseudo period. Three possibilities. I will show you soon an example, but let me make some remarks. The first thing is that I will assume P prime, P at least 3. Yeah? So the pseudo periodic doesn't happen. No? And well, it has to be orientation preserving because it's odd. So P is odd. Orientation preserving. Well, in particular, it says that if the fixed point set is non-empty, then it has to be a circle. Which is unknotted. And this was this was called the Smith conjectures until Thurston came and with the orbifold theorem and the orbifold machinery he proved this, that you have a secret action, orientation preserving action of the free sphere where the Cauchy is a geometric orbit. Yeah? But before the geometrization of Thurston, people already had this problem. Eh? This was called the Smith conjecture historically. I don't know how many of these. Yeah, this proved in the 80s. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes?
Does not occur.
Yeah? Because pseudo-periodic, you cannot. Pseudo-periodic means that it has no fixed point set, but some power has fixed point set, which is not the order. Okay, so prime order, we have just two cases. Okay, and the fixed point set is a set. Okay, let's. Well, we cannot talk about knots without making pictures. So let's put some examples. How do you construct this kind of guys? Well, you ask your student to draw it, but otherwise you do it for example. You do it for a thing, you start with a pattern. Okay? And then what I will do, I will repeat this part. So I start like this. So I just copy this. And then I take my notebook and I turn it. So I copy like this. Then I turn it again. I said that P was prime, but I will use 4.
Okay.
It's much easier to. I mean, because I have 4 sides in my notebook, right? Otherwise, I would. I will give you something of order for. But for the... I kind of. And now I just join this. Well, you know, in my notebook it looks much nicer, but in the blackboard, but that's often the case. Okay? This is my note. And this is a periodic symmetry. This note has a periodic symmetry of order 4. Now, what's the fixed point set? The fixed point set is here. And that's a circle, but it's just an infinite line perpendicular to the blackboard that goes to infinity. So there is a more clever way to make this picture is that, okay, now instead of making this picture, I take again my pattern and I say, I mean, look at the quotient by this action. Okay. So now you take S3, K, and you multiply the action of the symmetry, and what you get is something like this. So what this picture is supposed to mean, so if you model out this S3 by the action of this rotation of order 4, you get the knot K, and that it projects to this zero thing, and the fixed point set, this is the projection of the fixed point set. I write it like this, which is it's the same line. The only thing is that here I don't draw the infinity, I just put a compact picture. And that's K divided by phi. Yeah? And this leaves in S3 divided by phi. Yeah? So what do I do? I do, this is a, I can consider the branch covering of order. And the branching locus is the red one. Now let me give it, I will use this later, I will give it a name, A. This is, it will be useful to think of this as an orbifold. That's the first thing. The second, that's an example, this will be an example of periodic symmetry. How can you construct a free symmetry, example of free symmetry? I now realize that this picture is too small, but okay. So, to get a free symmetry, choose P and Q coprime integers. With positive P. And what you do here is what is called a PQ then filling. Or P over Q. Well, that's the classical notation. In a snap P notation is PQ. What does it mean? It means that you do the following thing. You well, first of all, you fix a reference for the well. No, what you do is the following thing. You remove a neighborhood of A, which is a solid torus, and glue again. You remove a solid torus and you glue again a solid torus. That's a topology's work. And what you have to, this PQ specifies the filling, the gluing map, the new gluing map. And what the specifications are like this, so I need to take a basis for the two torus around A, so I call it new. Maybe I write it larger here. So that's A. So I have an element here that I call it mu, and another element that's mu for meridian, and another element for longitude. So lambda mu, that they span pi one of the boundary of this solid torus. There are bases for Z plus Z. Sorry, the boundary, these two torus, yeah, the boundary of the solid torus. And what that means? It means that I grow again so that the boundary of D2 times that point, this is homotopic to the curve P mu plus Q times lambda. So I can, if the 1-0, then filling you do nothing. Yeah? If P goes 1, I mean, mu is the boundary of a disk now. I remove a solid torus and I grow again, but with this new curve, which is P times around mu and lambda times Q times around lambda. PQ are coprime, so that's a primit, that's a simple closed curve on the two torus. And for P larger than one, this is Allen's space. But it's called LPQ. Huh? Well, I don't know if it's Q or the inverse of Q. I think it's Q, but it's not important. The key thing is that now that LPQ is covered by S3. It's a finite cover. The fundamental group of this kind is the cyclic group with p elements. So there is a finite cover. So what I do, I take the knot here and we leave it here, and that's a free symmetry. So I give a knot to a name to the yellow guy. I call it this K knot. So lift to S3 that covers LPQ and this gives you S3K, a knot with a free symmetry. Well, it could be a link. Yeah? There is something important here in this example. The linking number is 3. So it means that this goes 3 times. It crosses 3 times. Huh? And this is something well defined. So let's take P coprime with the linking number. For this example, if you take this, and here also, Pico prime, looking up. Okay, because you realize that here I'm permuting the three components. So if I make a picture of this three times, I don't have a knot, I have a link, I have three components, that's a Borromean ring. Okay? So given that the expression that I'm really bad on knot theory, so this is the best I can, this picture I can make. In general, in general, these things are not easy. I mean, they are not easy to draw, but you can think of this from the quotient. Yeah? There is a symmetry finite order, so I think of these things as in the quotient. If it's a branch covering, it has fixed point. If not, it's in a Lenz space. Yeah? In a Lenz space, what I do, I think of the Lenz space as the depth filling. I replace this link, this component, this circle, I replace it by a solid torus so that this is a Lenz space, and this has a finite covering, which is S3. Yeah? And this gives me a free symmetry. To give the explicit example, it can be non-trivial to make the picture of the world. Okay, so let me. Let me state the theorem. Which is the following one. Let K in S3 be a knot. With a periodic, so with fixed points. Symmetry of prime order. P equals 3 is nothing but odd prime order. Then the variety of characters of this knot, so it's 3 minus k, has at least pi minus 1 over 2 components that are curves and are contained in the invariant set, so the symmetry, I would call it phi of the time, are contained in the invariant set, so this is the set of characters, so that when I compose with the induced map on the fundamental group, it is the same. So this phi induces a group automorphism, so this acts on the variety of characters. So this, it makes sense to talk about the invariant characters, okay? So what the theorem says is that this has at least p minus 1 components. Those components are curves, and they are contained here, okay? There are a few remarks about this. Well, as I said, it's not easy to find to compute varieties of characters. I mean, you have to think that periodic knots with symmetries, in this case it has fixed points, but in general knots with symmetries are kind of complicated. You need a lot of crossings to have big symmetries. You need a lot of crossings, so somehow it's a way to produce components without having to compute explicitly. This is one thing. The other thing is that, it's not surprising that you have a lot of components, because when knots are complicated, they may have a lot of components, and this is what happened here. But there is an important, let me put a remark that this that allows me to distinguish this from the free case. But this, the behavior in the free case is completely different. Sorry, Mark. For each P. For each prime. The idea is to take large primes, at least three, but for each prime P that exists, a knot K in S3 with a phi symmetry of order P. And, well, if you look at the components of, I cannot control all components, but I control the invariant components and a bounded number of, well, this depends on P, has at most, say, 20 components. Perhaps 20 is not optimal, but it's just a number. So, this theorem is false. What I want to say is that this theorem is will be false in the free case. So with periodic symmetries give you a lot of components of the variety of characters. And they are invariant. Yeah? If you could look at free symmetries, there are counterexamples. In general, I don't know. We don't know in general, but it's easy. There are a lot of examples like this. Yeah? You can here I give you a family. And there is an infinite family, so for each p there is a the knot depends on p, of course, because it's the number of symmetries of the knot, and this is always bounded. You can consider knots with as many symmetries as you want, free symmetries of prime order, and then the number of components of the variety of characters is different. So somehow, well, I don't claim that this has any application, okay? No, no way, I don't claim that. The only thing I want to say is that, well, it was just, it may help or not to understand the variety of characters, perhaps. Yeah? In general, understanding the variety of characters is a difficult issue. Yeah? It's not a trivial thing, but here we saw a different behavior. Yeah? I mean, one thing is to look at free symmetries, the other thing is to look at symmetries with fixed points, periodic symmetries. Okay? So let me try to prove that. Okay, so here's the, let me start the proof here. Let me start the proof. So let's introduce a notation. We call M to be S3 minus the knot, the exterior of the knot, and phi, sorry, the proof of the theorem, not of the remark. Phi is the symmetry. And the fixed point set is a circle, and it's contained in it, right? Because it preserves the knot, it cannot intersect the knot. If I had symmetries of order 2, they could cut the knot, but this is the only possibility. Well, and I will look at this guy as an order 4, at the quotient, okay? So, O will be the quotient of M divided by phi. And this is a normal form. Okay? This is a normal form with underlying space. It's S3 because it's the action of phi has to be orthogonal. Right? The action of the symmetry has to be orthogonal. It's just a rotation. It has to be something like this. Here I have the fixed point set here, and this goes to the singular locus of the orbit, which is fixed phi divided by phi. That's the branching locus. Which in my picture, it would be this guy here, okay?
Do you want your overflow to be S3 modulo 5 or a modulo
5? Right. Minus cannot. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah. Because it's my overflow is S3 minus the knot. So I would remove cannot, which is the projection. Thank you. Okay. Right. I'm missing something here because I missed something important in the field. Sorry. The hyperbola. Yeah. Otherwise, this is because this is, I don't think that.
And for torus knots, it's the direct calculation.
Yes.
Yeah.
For right.
Satellite knots, I guess, the issue.
Satellite knots, I have no idea. Yeah, for torus knots, that's you can explicitly compute all these things, and you're right. And symmetries are things I will know. And in part, yeah, because I'm going to use that always hyperbolic. It's hyperbolic. Because this isometry, this phi has to be an isometry, and this is a hyperbolic orbifold. So now I will need to consider. I want to prove things on the variety of representations of S3 minus K, but I will work with the variety of representations of the orbifold. So, I need to relate. What's the relation between both groups, the group of the manifold and the group of the orbifold? Well, this is an orbifold covering, so that's a group extension. So, pi 1 of O, it has a subgroup, which is pi 1 of N. And by this I mean the group of the orbifold. And the kernel, that's a normal subgroup. Distinguishes frames. For normal, or used to be French many years ago for normal. That's a normal subgroup, and the kernel is the cyclic group with p elements. You can think that this cyclic group is the group of the orbifold covering. And, there is an important thing here that makes already a difference with the free case, is that if you take mu, this guy here, this element around the singular locus, so you have mu meridian around the branching locus. Well, this is an element of finite order. It has order p. Yeah? What it tells you is that this is split. Or there is a section to it. Well, this element is not contained in here, and it has finite order. So it's contained in the group. It tells you more that if you consider the induced automorphism of the fundamental group, okay? That's the same thing as conjugating by mu. So phi star of gamma is the same as mu gamma mu minus 1. When you see gamma, m as a subgroup of O. So this element here And this is already a bit different with the free case, right? Because we have finite order elements. Okay? Or you can put this differently and say that what's the fundamental group of the orbit for? Well, it's the fundamental group generated by pi 1 of m. Let me write it like this. And mu, with the relations mu p equals 1 and this relation here. Okay? It's a kind of HNN extension, but with mu of finite order. Okay? So that this is to understand the relation between both groups. And I'm already using quite strongly that this has, I'm using strongly that this has fixed points. Okay, so maybe I'll leave the picture because I'm very proud of this picture, even if not theorists would say that this is trivial. So I need to work with the relative characters of M and more, so I need to understand what the relation between both groups. So that's, this blackboard is for the relation between groups. And here's the first lemma. Well, I can consider the restriction map from the variety of characters of the orbit form. Let me skip the notation for pi 1 because this means restriction to the variety of characters of the manifold which are phi invariant. So m is S3 minus k, so that the characters that satisfy this. And just take irreducible characters. This is a bisection. Okay? So I have a bisection between this. Well, that's an algebraic map. In general, it's not injective, not bijective, but if I restrict to reducible characters, this is a bisection. It means the following. It means that every time I have an irreducible character here, I can extend it to here in a unique way. That's what I say. Yeah? So let me prove this lemma. So I take, as I said, I take an irreducible character here, and I want to extend it here, and this has to be done in a unique way. Let chi be a character here, a character of a representation. This means that it satisfies this relation. Okay? And if I look at the representation now, well, the characters are irreducible. So the character determines rho up to conjugacy. So what I have is that rho composed with phi with the induced map is not rho, it's conjugated to rho. This uses irreducibility. And the other important thing is that, well, I will use this A matrix for the extension. So is it unique? Well, it's almost unique. Eh? This is for each gamma in the group. Is it unique? No, it's unique, but it's unique up to sine because rho is irreducible. So there exists unique up to sine. There exists a matrix. Unique up to sine. So it's plus or minus A. And this is used in the reducibility. Reducibility means that the centralizer of a matrix has to be plus or minus the identity. And what I want to do? Well, I want to extend it to the whole group, so I need to find the image of mu. Yeah? And well, that's A is the candidate for the image of mu. But in fact, what do I have? I have that the p power of phi star, because I have the relation here is the identity. So A to the power of P is plus or minus the identity. And P is odd, so there is a unique choice of sign such that A to the power of P is the identity. So set rho of mu to be this matrix. And that's the extension. So that's really elementary. Elementary theory representations into SL2. Yeah? Mm-hmm. So the fact that they are conjugate, they give you the matrix that you want. This is going to be very useful. Well, this is all I will do about the proof. The proof is not finished because there are accidents that could happen. Yeah? What would be an accident here? The accident here is that I have an irreducible representation and the restriction is not irreducible. This may happen. Well, this may not happen here. And this may not happen because P is odd. And in fact, that's technical. And it's not much more, it's again elementary, but the idea is that in SL2, if you have a representation such as an irreducible one, and in this group is reducible, it means that here it's a diagonal representation and you add permutations. But we have order P, so permutations, we cannot permute to rows with P odd. Right? So I'm somehow cheating. Maybe I need to, well, I need a wrapper, but maybe I'll use this one. So just so let me put it like this, can check that that the restriction of rho, that if rho is irreducible, then the restriction of rho is in R of M is irreducible. Because P is odd. If P was even, this would be false, because you could have here a representation which is diagonal and you say that mu just permutes the two guys. And well, that's something which is kind of, it's elementary, but you have to do it, and I will not insist on that, and I better will continue the proof. Okay, so we have this lemma, and with this we can really start the proof of the theorem. Yeah? Proof. Continue. Okay, so we had all the elements for the proof. Now what we do? What we do? We look at the notes. Okay, yeah. We use that O is hyperbolic. It's hyperbolic. Because, well, since the note is hyperbolic, so M is a hyperbolic manifold, and by the orbifold theorem, O is a hyperbolic orbifold. So it has an holonomy representation. Maybe I should use a larger. And here is O. Okay. and I want to leave it here. Well, in general, for many faults, you can always leave the presentation special to see. For Orbi faults, you have to be careful, but P is odd, so you can lift it. Yeah? It's essentially what it says here. Yeah? You can choose the sign so that it's satisfied. If P, here I'm using that P is odd. If P is even, that's complicated. There's maybe faults, right? You may not leave some. A rotation over there too is a matrix whose square is minus the entity, and then you can really not leave it. But here you can lift it. And the lift, again, it's not unique, but just take a lift. Row not a lift of the order. Okay? And now the key thing is that this is a representation into SL2 of a number field. And I look in my notes that the number field is called K2, of course. But they're not. So I try to do a different K. I don't know. I'm not in really. And this is a number field. So this means a finite extension of, well, I know you know very well what's a number field. Finite extension of Q. And we'll play, that's, of course, this doesn't need to be arithmetic, but still the fact it's a number field will be important for the group. Because what we will do, we look at the image of this guy, of this meridian. So if that's the meridian around the singular locus, you have to think that the orbifold is it has branching locus, the quotient of the fixed point set, which is a circle, and then the node projects to some k0, which is something here, okay? Well, that's a rotation of, in fact, with the extension we take, this has to be a rotation of order p. So it's conjugated, and here you have a root of the unit p. Which is non-trivial, huh? And it's more convenient to take it prime. Well, that's the statement of the theorem. Maybe I should keep this. So I'm start to run short of blackboards. There are so many blackboards. That's a difficult choice now. Because here I have the notation. Well, yeah, I will keep this notation. I will continue down. Okay.
Can you reach that graph?
Pardon?
No, not the picture.
I will keep this picture because that's really what we have for the quotient, right? And the other one, it's really bad. All this construction essentially was using this lemma. So maybe I can write this. So, what do I know? This is a number field, and this is a root of unity. Well, I know that the trace of this belongs to some field. So, I will look at Galois conjugate field. So, I think I can choose a larger number field, a Galois number field. I don't think if it's called Galois or normal or extension or whatever. It's something that it has the full Galois group that it needs. I can take a larger number field. And I will look at the trace of this and I will distinguish components by looking at Galois conjugates. So what do I know? I know that my notes are here, yeah. So maybe I should. Yes, I know that. Okay, let me write it like this. I look from the variety of characters of the orbifold, the trace of mu, the trace function of mu. And This has to be this has to be a two times a cosine as well. In fact, and I have t let me say it like this of rho zero sigma, and where sigma belongs to the Galois group of this number field, and this is maybe I should, well, I look at the Galois conjugate of these, of those guys. So these are two times the cosinus of 2 pi over p times r, where r goes from 1 to p minus 1. And it's important that p is prime. To say all possible guys. So, and here I have p minus 1 over 2 elements. Okay, there are several issues. First one, it could go that, it could happen that the meridian is mapped to a trivial element, so on, so let's say just some components. But, well, the issue is that, well, it either goes to here, it either goes to 2, yeah? Because it could be the trivial root for some components, but I'm not interested in those. So maybe instead of some components, just send me union 2. That, now this is correct. Yeah? The trace map of this meridian, that's an element of order 2. For the randomly representation, it goes to some of these guys. Well, I know which one, but it's not relevant. It's not. But you can realize all conjugates, all Galois conjugates of these roots, but just taking Galois conjugate. The second issue is that the Galois group can be very large, can be much larger than that. But okay, you don't care. Eh? So you can take here. The important thing is that this is an algebraic map, and that takes a finite number of values. Two may be realized or not, I don't care. But those can be realized by just taking Galois conjugates. And that's the important thing, because this allows me to distinguish components. In this way, I will have different components. So now the work, and now you understand why did I put this lemma here, is that this gives me components in the variety of characters of O. And then I have to leave to give back components in the variety of characters of L. And that's why I have this lemma. Okay, this is why I have this lemma, and then everything. I mean, this is the key idea. The key idea is that is I never thought in my life that I would use the Galois group. But sorry, but it's not so useless. As but I was already convinced today that it wasn't useless at all. But I never thought that I would use it myself. Okay? So this allows to distinguish at least p minus 1 over 2 components, and the work will be to leave them. And of course, it's important that p is prime. If p is not prime, you use the Euler function of not of the cyclotomic field, but the real extension, the real subfield, blah, blah, blah. You can realize this, but let's just stick to the prime case, okay? So let be components that contain Galois conjugates of rho zero of the lift of, this is the lift of the holonomy and distinguished by tau. yeah, distinguish. Not only, again, this representation has many Galois contours. Has lots of, we have lots of them. But I don't care, well, I don't care. I just take P minus 1 over 2, so that this takes different values. And this gives me components. And now, what can I say about these components? They are curves. Why they are curves? Because this Darisky tangent space, this Raghunathan theorem, tells me that for rho 0, let me write the group homology, H1 of this guy, this has dimension 1. That's because that's the singular locus, but we have removed this, the projection of the knot, K knot. That's what Raghunathan tells me. But you know what I wrote at the beginning in this black course, it's just something which is Raghunathan theorem uses let's say analysis, uses differential geometry and differential forms and you work have to work with the reals. But to compute this cohomology, the group cohomology is something that you can do in any number field. And if you take the Galois conjugate, it will not change. Let me call it, for all Galois conjugate, this is still the same. And we use a theorem of differential geometry, but then for the Galois conjugate, we have this. So we are happy with this because this gives different curves. Okay, and now the job is just using this lemma to lift them. Okay, so how do I lift them? The next step is lift. I have the variety of characters of O, the variety of characters of M which are invariant. This means that, yeah, that's this written here. And then I will look at this inside Xn. So here I have these components, y1, yp minus 1 over 2. And then, well, that's the restriction. And here what I do, I take the image, and I take the closure. I call it W. So what do I know? Well, these are curves, and this is, I mean, doing algebraic geometry with curves is something I still can more or less understand. What do I know? I know that y, each component, y1, is the union of the irreducible characters. Well, yeah. Rho 0 is irreducible, and its conjugates too. Yeah? That's a risky open, so it's union of finite set. Well, I also know that the image of, this map, this is a bijection, this is not a constant map, that's already something. So what can I say is that W1 is the image, perhaps some finite set. So it's the image of this, of the irreducible ones, union of finite set. But this, okay. Now I know that this is a bijection. What I can conclude is that WP minus 1 over 2 are different curves. Okay? Because it's just, I look at, away from finite set, this is a bijection. So these are curves. So these are curves, and these are contained in here. And I'm almost done with my theorem. There is only one thing I need to do, one thing left, is to prove that these are in fact components of this. But here I use again I use again Raghunathan's theorem. The first cohomology group, the Sariski tangent space at the random mean, not of the orbit before, but of M, but this is the restriction, the Sariski tangent space at the random mean of here is one, so it has one dimension. And I always have the argument, again with the conjugates, with the Galois conjugates. So, So here's the result. So rho zero restricted from the end is the economy. Is a lift. Well, and rho zero sigma. So again by the H1 of now pi 1 of M adjoint of the restriction is as one thing to see, and also for the Galois conjugates. Because for the field, everything is the same field, it's just restriction for as a restriction. So those are components. That's the proof. So we really use that, the trick with the numbers. So let me, and that this finishes. So it's what it says is that, well, there are many ways to construct components as varieties of characters, and those comes from the symmetry, those comes from the orbit for lobsters, and in fact you can lift it, which is, it keeps track of the quotient. So let me say something of this remark. Why this is not, this kind of result is not true anymore when we have free symmetries? And here I will use this example. So it was good to keep it. So let me say why this is true now. Why? How do you work out this remark? Just a sketch it, of course. Now call L this link. So here's an explanation. This link is something which is well known. That's for not series. This is the link 6 to 2. It has 6 crossings. 1, 2, 3. Well, here there are more crossings, but it's not alternated. So you can decrease the number of crossings up to 6. And it has 2 components. And in fact, if you want, no. I was saying that I can. Yes. This link. Of course, the last meter that I'm unable to draw. I'm almost. Almost. No. Okay. Well, this link is the same as this one. So I have a component that I call A and a component that is called B. Okay, we can think of this one. So the variety of characters, I will not give you the computation now, but the variety of this guy has 2 components again, only 2 components. One is the abelian component, which I don't care, and the other one is the canonical component, distinguished component. And these are the only 2 components. And in fact, you can look at the restriction map from x0 of this link, s3 minus this link. And you look at the restriction map two distorts. So the neighborhood, the Toulard neighborhood of the boundary of the Toulard neighborhood of the component A, which is the red component here. Okay. This you can do it by hand. Yeah? That's, I mean, somebody else had already computed this example, and this you can do compute it. And the important thing is that this map has finite fiber. Generically, finite to one. Well, this is a surface. These two guys are surfaces. This has dimension 2, there are two components. This has dimension 2 for, because that's the torus, and I gave you the other day the explicit equation. Generically, it means that except for a finite set, the inverse image has some bound. I don't remember, 6, 10, I forgot. But there are some points whose inverse image is a line. This may happen, but it's finally made. Okay, and then what's the next step with this? So how do we construct those examples? We do PQ then filling. Then filling on A. That I explained before, but you impose that P mu plus Q lambda. And here mu and lambda are a peripheral basis here. Go to the identity. And this, if you impose this, what you get? You get a line. The important thing is that P and Q are coprime. To have a simple closed curve, what you get? You get a line in X. Call it L in here. Huh? That's the variety of characters of the two torus. And you say, okay, what happens if I take a large P? If nothing, it's again a line, because it's a primitive element. Right? I mean, you can always choose a basis for this is a primitive element. You can always find a second element so that they span the torus. You can choose this. In fact, I didn't spend time the other day, and I should have. If you look at the variety of characters of the two torus, it has a lot of symmetries, and you can replace the basis, and you can choose any element, it will have the same picture. So just get only one line, which is very different, but of taking the trace of the meridian. If you impose that this has finite order, you get P minus 1 over 2 lines, and here we get only one line, and that's the key difference. That's the key difference, because this gives the inverse image of this. This maps, this is finite to one, has at most, I don't know, 20 components. And this gives you, and this is the sense, you can identify this as the variety of characters of the length space minus the other component. Because when you do the filling, you get a length space, so the inverse image is just that. And this has almost 20 components. And then you can use this I'm saying something wrong here, because here I was using that this has finite order, but you can use something similar to what? You can use a similar argument to control the number of components of x0 of S3 minus when you lift it. Or the components that are invariant. You can do this kind of construction. But the key point now is that when you look at the variety of characters of the torus, here you only have one component. In the other case, we have several components. And yes, I'm sorry, but I'm running over there. Thank you very much.
Is it an obstruction to doing a similar theorem for links as opposed to knots, the dimensions coming from Ragan-Athens theorem?
No.
There's other issues with.
No, it's just when here say I'm more familiar. Well, Luisa is a knot theorist. I didn't say that, so people knot theorists care about knots. But I'm not sure. The only assumption, maybe the only difficulty will be here, that you, but probably not. Instead of finite set, you just think of codimensional proper sets or something like this. Yeah, maybe it works. Yeah, thank you. No, Ragan-Athens theorem is of course applying.
Have a good safe trip back to your home.
Thank you.